the bowl, there is a flower in a seed, an apple tree. In cocoons, a hidden promise, butterflies will soon be free. In the cold and snow of winter, there's a spring that waits to be unrevealed until in season, God alone can see. There's a song in every silent singing word and melody. There's a dawn in every darkness, bringing hope to you and me. From the past will come the future, what it holds a mystery. Unrevealed until in season, something God alone can see. In our end is our beginning, in our time infinity. In our doubt there is believing, in our life eternity. In our death a resurrection, at the last a victory. Unrevealed until mid-season, something God alone can see.
Last week, Hannah and some of her buddies from her class in school, or our Sunday school class, we met out in outside in our lawn chairs and had pizza together. But we also were working on a book that would help us learn how to look things up in the Bible and kind of know how the Bible is laid out and where to look for different stories and things. And so I know that you probably have already finished that book. Is that right? Good. All right. And so that'll help you, but I just want you to know that there's lots of things to learn and that you'll continue to learn. This isn't just a one-time learning. You'll continue to learn and grow. And I hope that there'll come a time. I don't think maybe you've accomplished this goal, but you might have. Do you know all the books of the Bible in order so you don't have to look them up in the table of contents? Yeah, okay, that's a challenge. That's a challenge. And I would suggest that you start with the New Testament and learn those in order. And then try the Old Testament. That Old Testament is really hard because I even struggle with the minor prophets at the end of the book, keeping them straight where they're at. But that's something that will really help you if you'll learn the order of the books of the Bible, because it's just easier to find stuff fast. And then it makes it easier for you to want to pick it up if it isn't really hard every time you want to open the Bible. Now, I'm going to give you this Bible, and it's like perfect. I only opened up the front cover to put your name in it and to date it, that this is the day you got it. But if I would come back next year and it still looks as perfect as it does today, I'm going to be very disappointed, because that means you haven't opened it and used it. So you want the pages that be like, look like you've turned it into it every day. And if you have things that you see that really mean a lot to you, underline them, and you make me write a little note to yourself about what you learned in that part of the scripture. It's okay to write in your Bible. It's not okay to be disrespectful to it, but if it gets worn out, Jesus would be happy about that, okay? And I know that this Bible is not to be last forever, because it's for girls, and there's a day coming that you're going to be a young woman. You're going to outgrow this Bible, and you'll get another one. But hopefully this will be helpful to you in the next few years, that you can be directed to be the woman of God that God's created you to be with a young lady, okay? All right, can I have a prayer with you right now? Okay, and then after we have the prayer, it would be okay to applaud. Jesus is okay with that. It's all right. You can honk your horn in celebration, okay, after we have our prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you for Hannah. We thank you for her family. And when they started coming to church, I was so excited, because I just loved her enthusiasm, and I loved the way that she loved to learn about Jesus. And we've really missed her this last year, and not being able to be with her during this pandemic. So I pray, Father, that this Bible will be a symbol to her, that her church family loves her, and that we pray that she will grow in her faith, that she will know the God that could get her through a pandemic is the God that will get her through her whole life, and that the words in that Bible will be a reassurance to her, that there would be words of comfort to her in that Bible, that there would be words of hope, but also direction for her life, that she would know that when she needs to understand what she should do or where she should go, that she can turn to you and the word that you have to give to her through the Holy Spirit, burning those words into her heart and mind. Thank you so much for her family that are faithful to bring her up in the Lord, and we ask, Lord, you would guide them by the Holy Spirit as she shares her Bible with them, that they would read together, and that it would truly help them to grow closer to you and closer together as a family. And I pray all of this in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church, we are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation, and given new birth through water and the Spirit. And all this is God's gift offered to us with Christ. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, Tracy, as you are going to be baptized, and you're not a baby, you're old enough to answer these questions for yourself. On behalf of the whole church, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sins? And if you do, say, I do.
I do.
Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? And if you do, say, I do. We talked about this, and I know Mom and Dad have talked to you about this, about the fact that we know that Jesus died on the cross for us. And we believe in Jesus. We believe in that he died and rose from the grave, and that he is our Savior. And we invite him to be in our hearts and lives. And I want you to know that I did this very same thing when I was your age, but there will be a time when you get in high school, when you get in college, that you'll come back and reaffirm this as you begin to understand more and more about who Jesus is in your life. There'll be other times that you'll say this again, you'll confirm it again, that you understand it even deeper and more than you did when you were at first here with me. Okay? So, will you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? Do you want to do that today? Say, I do. And for you, Tracy and Chrissy, will you nurture Nathan and Ethan and Connor in this church? Get them to Sunday school. Get them vacation Bible school. Let them go on spiritual retreats. Open the Bible at home. Read it on a regular basis. Pray with them. Pray for them. Will you be that kind of example to them and guide them to accept God's grace for themselves, to profess their faith openly, to lead a Christian life? And if you will, say, I will.
I will.
To you who are here representing our church, do you as Christ's body of church reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life, and include Ethan and Connor that are now before you in your care?
God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness, that they may grow into the trust of God and be found faithful in the service of others. We will pray for them.
Thank you. Now, we talked a little bit about this when you and I got together, and I just want to remind you that this is river water. And it's water until we pray over it, and then it becomes very special water. It's holy, holy. It is a reminder to us that there is nothing else in life that we can do. You know, we can get by with not drinking soda and milk and stuff. But if you don't have water, you would die. And Jesus said, I am the living water. And so we know that his life poured into us and gives us a chance to pour that life into other people. And also, it's a reminder that the only thing that really gets us clean is water. And so when we are, you know, in that place of baptism, we are thinking about the fact that when we do things wrong, when we sin, and we ask Jesus to forgive us, it's his living water that washes over us and cleans us up. And also, this water, even Jesus was baptized because he wanted to be an example that when we say we want to be in his family, we're baptized. So we are adopted into his family. And so you have a new family, not just your family that last name is Adair. But your family is wherever you go in the world, you have family because other Christians are your brothers and sisters. When I went to Liberia, Africa, even though they were singing in a language I didn't know, but when they were singing Jesus Loves Me, I just sang loud and bold in English while they were all singing in French and in their tribal languages. I want you to know that wherever you go, you got a church family that will care about you, even if you were in another country. So I want you to know that you are joining huge family around the world. When we sing that song like we did at the parking lot services, we got the whole world in his hands. He really means that. He really does have the whole world in his hands. So as we pray for this water, it becomes that place of holiness. Eternal Father, when nothing else existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth life. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood of water, you set in the clouds a rainbow. And when you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of God's mercy each day. In the fullness of time, he was sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of the womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism, the death, and resurrection, and to make disciples of all nations. Declare his works to the nations, his glory among all the peoples. Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water, and Ethan and Connor, who are to receive it, wash away their sin, clothe them in righteousness throughout their lives, that dying and being raised with Christ, they may share in his final victory. All praise to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you in the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen. We have designated that Ethan is going first. And you know what, grandmas and grandpas, you want to come up, you're welcome to be closer. And it's okay to bring your camera. It really is. Because, you know, in the moment, they may not see everything they need to see. And this will be a good reminder to them. And it's a good historical thought. You ready? In the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Ethan James Amir, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the lives of Ethan and Connor. We thank you, Lord, for having just grown so much in their awareness of who God is in their lives in this past year. We thank you for the grandmas and grandpa who have daily worked with them through this pandemic, tutoring them. But I know that they didn't just talk about math and reading, but they were living before the examples of what it is to be a Christian, to live life in the midst of it. I ask, Lord, that you would watch over this family and your grace and mercy, that you would continue to help them to grow in their faith, their understanding, and their love for you and love for each other, bind them together. Especially, Lord, I ask that you would be even clear that they would truly grow up to be the men of God that you created them to be, and that you would help their parents and their parents to know how to speak your truth into their lives. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Now, Connor and Ethan, I have these for you. I'm going to give these to Mom. These are your certificates, okay, that you have word. This is official today that you're baptized. And you are really lucky because I'm moving and we're getting good at things. And I found on the wall in Roger's office, he had a whole wall that was just full of different crosses that he's gotten from different places and so forth. So I asked him last night if I had permission to give Christ to you, and he was like, yes, he wanted me to have it. So I'm going to give these to you, and each of these are made of nails, and they are to remind you that Jesus loved you enough. If you were the only two boys in the whole world, he was still mad at the cross for you. He loved you that much, and if he died for you, I want you to know he wants you to live. So I'm going to hand these to you, and if for some reason you like his better and you like yours better for a trade, it's okay. We just didn't have a matching one, so, but they were both nails. Now, here's the other thing I want to give. This is for you, your family. So you as a family can decide where you want to put it in the past. But this is to help you remember this was your spiritual birthday. I would encourage you maybe to have a little piece of paper or something on the back, at least the date, and then you have this. And in particular, I wanted to show you, it kind of shows the life of Jesus as the shepherd, as pleased to represent the Holy Spirit. We know how important the Bible is because we're men of Connor, the makers, we're you. But also, this is the part that means the baptism. And I didn't know that when I was your age. But this is a church symbol for baptism because when they used to baptize people along the Jordan River, they would take shells that would be on, and they would pick the shells up, and they would put water in, and they would pour it over people's heads. So that's why it has a shell that shows like the Jordan River. And then we have a symbol of that of Jesus' resurrection. You know how he moves, you know, put the caterpillar inside, and they change, and it moves to that new life. And then how Jesus prayed, he did the Father's will, and the importance of prayer, and the importance of Holy Communion. So it's kind of all the things about being a Christian, what that means. So I'll let you take that home and you guys can decide.
Thanks.
Okay.
It's good.
What
do you say?
Thank you. You're welcome. And now let us, there is one more place. It's on page 43. And we say these words. Through baptism, you are incorporated by the Holy Spirit into God's new creation, and made to share in Christ's royal priesthood. We are all one in Christ Jesus. With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you as members of the family of Christ. Members of the household of God, amen. We can honor to you. To your love and care, do all in your power to increase their faith and further hope and perfect them in love. Training last week, and then he had some homework to do, or he was to finish the training, did you do that?
Okay, all right. So you're going to go home and do it, right? Good. Okay. And this Bible is a special Bible. Now, usually we have them all alike, and I always think, well, I'm going to give them a Bible so they have the whole life. But because of the pandemic, I felt like they have lost a whole year of what would have been good Sunday school time and everything. So we have invested as a church for boys' Bibles. Now, these boys' Bibles, they're awesome because they have a place in it that's the grossology of the Bibles. And so all the gross things, it highlights it. I mean, what other boy would not want that kind of Bible? So I wanted you to have that. I hope you have a lot of fun with this. I also hope that it is an awesome place. You listen to God. Because if you have a relationship with God, you have to listen to Him. You can talk to Him anytime. Sometimes there are people that get in that habit, they just talk to him all the time and they never stop to listen to him. If you read his letter, that's him speaking to you. Okay? So I hope that you will do that every day. And I want you to know that if this Bible looks this good in a year, shame on you. Because if you open it and use it a lot, it'll wear. And it'll show that you will open it. It won't have clean pages. And if there's things in there that you want to underline, you do it, okay? You make it so that you learn from it. And don't worry about keeping it nice. Don't throw it around. Be respectful to it. But you need to use it. Do you know my favorite Bible has duct tape all over it just to keep the thing together? And I think God's pretty happy about that. You know, that I've used it so much that I had to duct tape it back together. Okay? So let's pray, and then we all let you do that. Lord Jesus, I do thank you I thank you for his honesty. I thank you, Father, for the incredible man of God that he will be. And I know that the incredible plan is he opens this Bible and reads it. Maybe there'll be places that he'll go, oh, you didn't know that was in there? And there may be places that he'll kind of chuckle. And then there'll be places that he will just say, God is all over this. Speak it to me personally when I need guidance and help. So I pray all of this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
We have a very, very special treat that is, I guess, for me. Because I didn't know that this was going to happen until Dr. B said something. This is Dr. Jim Van Snijveren, who is the one regret I had in life is I was not able to be one of his students. But he has let me into his life as a friend. And I first realized that he was a banjo player. And then I learned that he also was a harpist. And I have encouraged him to become the world's first bluegrass harp picker. But as of yet, he has not taken me up on that challenge yet. But anyway, I just want to say, Dr. B, I valued our friendship, and it is an honor to know that you are here to praise God with your talent and harp playing. So, please, sir. Thank you. Edison?
Yes.
Good. Edison, we have a tradition of handing out Bibles to intelligent young ladies like you and young men. But you had to read a book, right, to learn about the Bible. And I heard that when Pastor Joy gave you this book, your mom told her, she went home and you read it the first night, right? You had the thing read the first day. And then I heard that you decided to read it again, make sure you didn't miss anything. Is that right? Isn't that cool?
Yeah.
And I still have my first Bible. It's kind of beat up. So old, real old. This one is new. And Joy wanted me to tell you something. She said, this is new, it's really nice. It is a Bible, kind of did something special during the pandemic here. And that is, we've got really nice Bibles. And you'll see it says Girls Life Application Study Bible. So it's something that's going to speak to you right now for the next few years. When you become a woman, you will get another Bible, an adult Bible, but this will speak to you right where you are. Okay? Now, Joy had a message that she wanted to give to you. She said if she comes back here and she has a chance to see this Bible, she doesn't want it to look like this. She wants it to look used, like you've not abused it, but that you really read it and studied it and used it. And so she wants you to not just have it up on the shelf and let it collect dust. She actually wants you to learn, continue to learn. I know you will, because you read that book twice. So I'm going to pray for you and for this Bible. Is that okay? All right. Let you have it there. I'm going to stay right there. I'm going to stay over here because of the COVID thing. But I just want you to know that this is a big step. This is important. So let's pray. Lord God, I thank you for Addison and that she has come to the point in her life where she now has her very own Bible. I thank you for her eagerness to learn more about you. And how she's taking this seriously. And I ask that she continue, that she will do that on into her life. And that every day of her life will be an opportunity to walk with you. Lord, thank you for what you are going to do in this young lady's life as she grows closer and closer to you. Be with her family. Help them to be supportive and help her grow in to be the Christian that you are calling her to be. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Good to see you. Well, as you all know, this is Memorial Day weekend. It's a time in which we honor those who died in service in the military. And it used to be called Decoration Day. It actually began following the Civil War to honor those and recognize those who died in the Civil War. But since that time, there's been World War I. World War II, Korean War, the Vietnam War, Iraq and Afghanistan. And it was important and significant to expand that, and obviously it has through the years. And in 1968, Congress passed a Uniform Monday Holiday Act, which took it to Monday in 1971, was the first time that it began to be on Monday. It used to be on the 30th, which is today. So we are celebrating that today. And even though it is military in its beginnings, it also has been a time in which we recognize those who have died and gone before us that we love. Now, being here on
Memorial Day is still kind of new to me. 2019 was my first Memorial Day to be with you. Before that, you know, I've been here 11 years. Before that, I was with my family in Indiana. My mom and dad, they lived on a little lake there, and they had a flagpole that he had out by the lake. And every Memorial Day, the same thing would happen. In the morning, Dad, one of us kids would go with him, maybe more, and he'd lower the staff all the way down, the mat, the flag, all the way down the staff, and then he would raise it halfway. This was early in the morning. And it would stay at half staff on Memorial Day until noon. And then the whole extended family, nieces and nephews, cousins, brothers and sisters, aunts and uncles, anyone who was there, we'd all gather and around the in the yard, around the flag, and Dad would go and he'd raise the flag at noon on Memorial Day, all in honor of those who'd gone before. Dad was a true patriot. He loved his country. He served in World War II. He received the Bronze Star. He loved the flag. I was with him one time. I was over there, and he pulled out his Bible, and he said, "Here, I want you to read this." And so he handed me this poem. Okay. So I read these words: "There will be a great encampment in the land of clouds today, a mingling and a merging of our boys who've gone away. Though on earth they are disbanding, they are very close and near. For those brave and honored heroes, show no sorrow, shed no tear. They have lived a life of glory. History pins their medals high. Listen to the rolling thunder. They are marching in the sky." Wow. What a perfect poem for Memorial Day. Dad took him back and he put it in his Bible and said, "Roger, I want this read at my funeral." As if I really wanted to hear that. You know, your dad talking about his funeral. I said, "Well, you know, 100 years from now when that finally happens, yeah, we'll make sure it gets read at your funeral." He said, I'll put it here in the Bible. You'll know exactly where it's at. Well, it's been about 10 years. And that time came and Dad passed away. I got the word on the phone. And one of the things I told my sister who was there, I said, "Hey, in his Bible there was this poem. It's called Taps. It was written by Arden Nottingham Chappis. And if you would get that and have it ready for me, because we will want to use it in the service." He wanted it read at his funeral service. And Lynn said, "Sure, I'll get it." She called me back later and said, "I can't find it." Oh, great. Come on, sis. He said it was going to be in the Bible. It's got to be there. She looked again. "God, it's not there. There's other things in it, but it's not there." Okay. So when I finally drove to Indiana, I'm a younger brother, okay? You know, my sister, she makes mistakes. My sister. She doesn't know anything. You know, for the last 11 years, I've really given my sister a hard time. I love my sister dearly, but I love to give her a hard time. So I said, sis, let me see the Bible. She gives me the Bible. I go through it, I can't find it. Gee, she's right. It's not there. Others in the family go through the Bible, I can't find it. I pick it up one last time. I'm thumbing through it. And I get to the front flap. And Dad had pasted it on the front flap. And he did such a neat job, it looked like it was part of the printed Bible itself. So at the funeral, I knew I couldn't get through it. So I asked my nephew to do it. He said, sure, I'll do it. And he memorized it. And today, this morning, he sent it to me on his phone by memory after all these years. But on Memorial Day, we, even after Dad passed away, we would still gather at Mom's house. And we'd gather around that flag. And my nephew Russell would step up. And he would recite the poem by memory. There will be a great encampment in the land of clouds today, a mingling and emerging of our boys who've gone away. Though on earth they are disbanding, they are very close and near. How can we know for sure? Jesus comes to be with Mary and Martha in their grief. Their brother Lazarus died. And we see the story in John 11, 20 through 27. I don't have time to go through the whole thing, but I encourage you to go read it. John 11, 20, or, and it's in John 11. I'm just going to read those seven verses. And this is what happens when Jesus finally shows up. Martha heard that Jesus was coming. She went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. Sister is so upset, she stays at home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Your brother will rise again. Martha said, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Loved ones, hear what Jesus says on this Memorial Day weekend. Here it is. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. And then as he's looking at her, he says these words. Do you believe this? Do you believe this? And as we approach this Memorial Day, I think he is asking us the same question. Do we believe that Jesus is the resurrection and the life? If we believe in him, we will live even though we die. And whoever lives and believes in him should never die. Do we believe this? That's the question for today. It's important. It's important for us to get it right, to understand what exactly is happening in Jesus' comments. Martha said, if you had been here, Jesus said, your brother will rise again. Do you believe this? Charles Allen, in his book, When You Lose a Loved One, talks about this passage of Scripture. I love what he has to say. He says, Jesus said, whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. That is the most glorious promise ever made to humanity. We go to the cemetery. It is a spot, it is a sacred spot, which we bathe with our tears, but our loved ones are not there. They never have been there. They never will be there. You bury only things that are dead. And Christ assures us that through him, we will never die. The body dies and is buried. The person does not die, and therefore, is not buried. We remember the words of our Lord to the man dying by his side that day. He's talking about the crucifixion. He said, today you shall be with me in paradise. Not some dim, distant future. Today, not when some Gabriel blows a horn. Today, our life will not cease and start over again. It continues on in another place. The very moment we leave this body, we begin living in the next. Do you believe this? That's what Jesus asks. It's a change. And yeah, there's tears. Because the one that we love, we see no more. But they've gone to be with Jesus, which is the goal. There's a lot of things in life that are like this, where we have tears, even though it's a good thing. First day of school, kindergarten. How tough is that? Mom and dad struggle. Kids don't want to go. It's change. And sometimes there's tears. Life will never be the same again. Emma, when you went off to college, did you cry?
My dad cried.
I know he did. Mom probably did.
Which Emma were you talking to? I just answered.
That happens. Well, you cried? She was still in the Quad Cities. What are you doing, girl? Levi, I had tears. But it's good tears because there's a change and things will never be the same again. But it still kind of hurts because of the loss of the way things were. You moms who had a daughter get married, don't tell me you didn't cry. Yeah, Laura can testify to that.
2 weddings in 2 months. I bawled like a baby.
Oh, gosh. Yeah, it's a tradition where you see the bride's mother cry at weddings. But then there's the dad. You know, usually a total basket case. Dennis, you think it was bad seeing her go off to college? And the pastor stands like right here and watches this beautiful young lady come down the aisle, and Dad has her on his arm. And then I stand here And I asked the most stupid question known to human existence. Do you know what it is? You look right at the father and you say, who gives this woman to be married to this man? How could a dad give away his daughter? He said, he's standing there going, I ain't gonna say it. And she's elbowing him in the ribs going, Dad. And this is what he wants to say. He wants to say, I was there in the first couple of years of her life. She would cry at night and I would comfort her. I taught her how to ride a bike. And when she skinned her knees, I kissed them. And quite honestly, where was Mr. Wonderful when she was so sick she couldn't sleep and all I could do was just try to hold her and help her, throwing up all over the place? How can I give her away? Yeah, tears at a wedding, but they're good tears, but the tears are because it will never be the same. Memorial Day teaches us it will never be the same. But I want you to know, loved ones, that the ones that you love, you'll see no more, that they are safely within the home that they are called to be. Our final home in heaven with Jesus. If this miracle of Lazarus's being raised from the dead means anything, you know what happened, didn't you? Lazarus, after Jesus said these words, that I am the resurrection and life, he proves it by raising Lazarus from the dead. I'm not so sure Lazarus was happy about that, because that means he would have to die again. Do you ever think of that? I'm not sure he did Lazarus a favor. But it proved an important point, that this miracle is because Jesus is the resurrection and the life. It means that those who died in the love of God and in the true faith of Jesus Christ do not really die. They don't experience death. To those who died in the faith in Christ, life after death is this gift. To them, there is no death. It only is a change of place, a change of state. One passes at once, instantly, to a new life. With all the powers, with all the feelings, all of that is unchanged, but maybe purified, but still the same living, thinking, active persons who they were on earth. And I do say active. Come on, the Bible says nothing about sleeping till the day of judgment, as some have favored. Rest they may. There may be a rest if it's needed, but what really is rest? It's not idleness. Rather, it's things like peace of mind. A rest from never quite getting over the sin problem. A rest from sorrow and suffering, from fear and from doubt. That is true rest. Above all, to rest from the desire to be the best one can be, but never quite being able to pull it off. That is rest in the new, in the true sense of the word. It's rest in God. So as you go into Memorial Day this weekend and tomorrow, I just want you to remember about this changes in life thing. and realize that there will be a continuation. Because Jesus is the resurrection and the life. He has made that promise. Christ has entered through the gates of death and come back triumphant, victorious, having broken once and for all time the bonds in which death had held all persons. Amen? So, loved ones, death should no longer hold fear for us. It should be a triumphant entry in a new life. Why? Because Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me will never die. Do you believe this? Let's pray. I thank you, God, for a love so great that you have it taken care of when we lose a loved one. Thank you, Lord, for loving us so much that you came to die on the cross for our sin problem, so that we might go to heaven when we die. We love you, Lord. It's in Jesus' name I pray.
Thank you.